One had heard about, you know, Mantovani, and I didn't know how much production he would either need or, more to the point, want. And I remember my very first encounter was on the recording of Kismet. And during rehearsal, I heard a few things that I didn't think were quite right. And I went out to make my remarks to him, and he just glared at me. I mean, he just, as if, you know, he just glared. And of course, I tiptoed away. And later when he came in, he said, you know, he really kind of needed every opportunity to make all of those decisions for himself. And as I got to know him as a worker in the studio, he never needed any production. Monty ran his own show, did his own rehearsals, and did everything in one or two takes.
This control that he exerted over the production gave Mantovani that holy grail of popular music, an instantly recognizable sound. And though the world and the music business have changed, and romance and sophistication have been replaced by crudity, violence, and sensationalism, amazingly enough, Mantovani's music still sells. In fact, the growth of the nostalgia market has led to new interest, which may expose Mantovani to a new generation of listeners. He's already made it onto Brad Bigelow's online guide to space-age pop music.
The essence of Mantovani's style was really a seamless approach to the sound that he got primarily from his string section. If you compare Mantovani to a number of folks who he's often lumped in with, say, Andre Castellanets, what you really notice is the extent to which Castellanets really used the full range of the instrumentation of the orchestra, whereas Mantovani really tried to shoot for this very seamless, very, very smooth and highly integrated string sound. So there's just this sense primarily of the string section as one seamless instrument producing this blanket of sound that comes out. They were all very, very interested in the latest advances that came out in recording technology and microphone technology and the placement of microphones. And particularly because people like Mantovani were recording from the period when everything was essentially one-track recording into the period where you came out with stereo and then you had multi-track recording. They really allowed them, I think, to fine-tune the result that came out in terms of the finished recorded product. In quite a great contrast to the recording that was done for, say, rock and roll at that time, soul music at that time, where it was very much more oriented to come out with a product quickly.
Most of his recordings, Mantovani worked with sound engineer Arthur Lilly, who, in the days before digital reverbs and electronic effects, would reputedly go as far as removing carpets from concert halls to get that suitably echoey Mantovani string sound, exemplified there in Lonely Ballerina. And talking of those cascading strings, it's ironic that Mantovani's trademark sound was the creation not of the man himself, but of Ronnie Binge, an arranger who only worked with Mantovani for a couple of years. It was a phone call from Decca that set the strings cascading.
They asked if I could do a record of waltzes. Of course, in that period, the American orchestras, I think they were the best of all. They had some tremendous musicians playing that type of music. That's why it was so good. So I said, is there a chance if we can think of something else, something they don't use? And Ronald Binge, you know, who's a great composer these days himself, was scoring for me at the time, and he thought it would be a good idea. The only thing they don't use is their strings. So I had a fight with the Decca company to give me a chance to use really a mass of strings, because it's only a mass of strings that gives you a certain sound. Well, it took me a hell of a long time to convince Decca to try, because of the expense, as usual. And I said, all right, well, if you've got a really good idea, have a go. I remember being in the studio at that time when eventually, after going through four or five of the people, it was a very nice sound. We were pleased with the sound of what was coming out. And then Charmaine was played. And when we played it, it really sounded beautiful. And the whole of the orchestra were delighted with it. And when an orchestra's delighted, I start worrying. It's too good as a rule. You know, I don't mean that derogatory to anybody. I mean, It's musicians' music, and musicians look at things totally different, shall we say, from a commercial venture. And this happened to be a commercial venture from a deck of people with, you know, the price of the orchestra put in front of me every 2 seconds.
The sound itself is produced musically. I mean, it is the departure from a chord of certain notes, moving to another chord on a delayed system. And Binge himself described it as an echo. The cascading strings, I suppose, something the marketing people came up with. But it tells it quite well. I mean, it's similar to a bell effect in horns or trumpets. And it is very, very distinctive.
Shortly after its release in 1951, Charmaine was picked up by a Cleveland DJ called Randall, who was besieged by callers wanting to hear it again. Before long, it became the first in a series of million-selling singles for the Mantovani Orchestra. The gamble had certainly paid off for Decca. But for Mantovani, there was a downside.
You see, if you make a success of a style and people like you for it, it's very difficult to keep to it all the time for yourself because you're thinking, well, you must bore them with the same type of music. But it's a big mistake, funny enough. I refused to do more than, say, 3 records a year for them. Everyone thought I was mad, but as it turned out, I was right. You see, we never swamped the market with just one type of sound. I mean, the moment I could, I cut away from waltzes and start doing, you know, showpieces and things like that.
By no means, really, should one think of Mantovani in terms of only that sound. I mean, there were other identification marks, these great runs from the bass right through the strings to the top violins, which would hold a note and then begin a melody. Some Enchanted Evening is a perfect case in point. The orchestra begins right with the double basses, moves through to the cellos, then the violas, then the C violins, then the B violins, then the A violins, which hold the note just long enough to establish what we know as the lyric "Sum" and then Enchanted Evening. And it's a perfect kind of signature that Mantovani used over and over again.
Over the 60s and early 70s, Mantovani continued to apply his distinctive sound to the music of the time. Although he found it harder to find tunes that would suit his style, the Beatles, Simon and Garfunkel, even ABBA were all given the Mantovani treatment. By the mid-1970s, though, the champagne bubble was definitely starting to burst. Romantic music was going out of fashion for social and economic reasons.
It costs a heck of a lot of money to hire a 30-piece orchestra in a studio these days. So that's one of the reasons. And of course, companies like Muzak today, the new, what they call audio architecture, quote unquote, they'll tell you, well, we just don't like those sappy 101 string sounds, but it may be more economic than aesthetic. That's what I had suspected. And in order to make a less expensive music sound better than the earlier prototype, let's sort of badmouth what we call old-fashioned. But you said romantic, and I think that's a key word. I think there's a very unromantic mindset that's evolving. The more gritty and the more sexual and the more aggressive style of music, I think, is passing for more authentic. But it's no more authentic than anything else. It's just another pose.
When Dad died, Tony D'Amato came up to us and asked us if he could carry on with the Mantovani music. And, of course, I was delighted, not being a musician and having the faintest idea of the artistic world. And so he's in partnership with us and my sister. We have a company in America now called Mantovani Production Associates.
I can tell you from the reaction of crowds on tour that his music is still very much appreciated. I mean, the respectful treatment in some of those arrangements. I think that audience is still there. And I think the way young people are rediscovering swing today, I think probably that kind of treatment of that kind of quality popular music will always be there, always be with us.
And whether you like it or not, I'll be with you same time next week, 10 p.m. Tuesday night, when our featured artist will be the composer of Strangers in the Night, Bert Camfort. Meanwhile, thanks to our romantic researcher, Dominic Black, our prolific producer, Lindsay Moyes, and I've been your stranger in the night, Richard Niles, and promise to be even stranger next week when I hope you'll find some time for us on The Arrangers.
Thank you, Stranger in the Night, Richard Niles. 88 to 91 FM.